So good evening. My name is Shamika Ravi. Welcome to Brookings India. It gives me great pleasure to welcome Dr. Viral Acharya. I've known Viral for many years now. He was a few years senior to me at NYU, and definitely one of the more inspirational people in the field. Though he was in the finance department and I was in the economics department, but I've followed Viral's writings and literature since. He's also one of the few economists who built a very robust, broad literature, research agenda around banking. And this is a time when we need to rethink a lot within monetary policy, and because several countries are faced with first order problems when it comes to macroeconomic stability and fundamental monetary policy. So Viral, welcome to Brookings India. He's going to talk about unconventional monetary policy. And to all of you, you must have also received the lecture he gave last evening in Mumbai, which really links this particular academic paper to the broader relevance that it has for the Indian economy. So Viral, the stage is yours. We start late, but we will try to end, you know, end on time. So you have about 45 minutes, and then we'll have a Q&A at the end.
Okay, I'm really sorry for being late. We were about 25 minutes just on the road trying to find where number 6 was, because guards were able to tell us where it is, and we kept looking for big blue signs because everything else has a big blue sign. So. Anyway, somehow we made it in the end. So, why don't I get started without delaying too much? This joint work with Tim Isert, Christian Ufinger, and Christian Hirsch, they were all PhD students at Goethe University, and now they're all in different places, Erasmus, IESC Barcelona, and at the German Central Bank. I have to just add that these are my own views and not necessarily those of RBI, because I will be commenting on policies of another central bank. It's just like central bank policies, you know, they always come late and they don't work most of the time. So Mario Draghi, who is the ECB president, he stated on 26 July 2012 during a conference in London that when the Eurozone looked like it might be breaking up with Spanish and Italian sovereign debt problems looking unsustainable, that within our mandate, the European Central Bank will do whatever it takes to preserve the Euro. And the speech became famous as whatever it takes speech since then. And he said, believe me, it'll be enough. And the backdrop of this announcement is the following. If you look at this graph on the y-axis, it shows the spread between the Italian bonds and the German bonds at 10-year maturity. So it's a gap of two government bond yields at the 10-year maturity. The blue line is for Italy, and the red line is for Spain. And in a sort of a union such as the Eurozone, the expectation is that these spreads will basically be zero or very tiny. Maybe there might be some liquidity differences or something like that. But of course, lacking any fiscal arrangement, once the sovereign debt problems started looking problematic for Spain and Italy, you can see that during 2011, especially in fall of 2011, these spreads start becoming quite large, on the order of 250, 300, and 400, 500 basis points. ECB did the largest lender of last resort operation to date by a central bank in December of 2011. You can see that that had the temporary impact in bringing these spreads down. But by summer of 2012, the spreads have again skyrocketed to 500, 600 basis points. And that is when Mario Draghi announced that I stand ready to do whatever it takes. Now, of course, a central bank cannot do any fiscal transfers, which are lacking in the Eurozones, but a central bank can do open market operations. And so later on, by September 2012, August, September, they clarified that what we meant by whatever it takes is that we stand ready to purchase unlimited quantities of sovereign bonds of countries in the Eurozone if we think that that's necessary to prevent the breakup of the Eurozone. So the idea was that he's effectively giving an implicit guarantee, perhaps even explicit guarantee to the market, that if the spreads become too wide and market starts not believing that the Eurozone will stay together, then I will just start buying up these bonds and I'll support the prices of these bonds. And you can see it had the intended effect as far as saving the Eurozone was concerned, which is that these spreads have systematically come down since the announcement was made. Actually, no bonds were ever purchased under the OMT program, but the announcement that I'll do whatever it takes in terms of buying unlimited quantities had this stabilizing effect on the sovereign bond prices. Now, when this happened, it was expected that once the sovereign crisis was brought under control, that this would actually translate into real economic activity also getting a rebound. And in fact, what happened was that banks in countries such as Spain, Italy, Greece, Ireland, and Portugal, I'll refer to them as GIPS countries, G-I-I-P-S for Greece, Ireland, Italy, Portugal, and Spain. Banks in these countries which were holding their domestic sovereign bonds, because of this collapse in the Italian and Spanish and other countries' bond prices towards the German bonds, they immediately had improvements in their capitalization because the bond holdings improved in value and the banks could basically say that, listen, I've made treasury gains, I've gained in a mark-to-market basis on my assets, and then if the left-hand side of your balance sheet improves in value, you can mark that into your equity on the right-hand side. But then in November 2014, he acknowledged while announcing quantitative easing, which was a step to now say, I'm going to actually start buying the bonds in the market. I'm not just guaranteeing, I'm actually going to start buying the bonds. Even though the spreads had collapsed dramatically, he said, I'm going to go one step further and now get these bonds to improve in value even further. And he justified that by saying that the positive developments since the whatever it takes speech in the financial sphere have not transferred fully into the economic sphere. The economic situation remains difficult. The euro area exited recession in the second quarter of 2013, but growth momentum remains weak. Unemployment is only falling very slowly. Confidence in the economic prospects is fragile, easily disrupted, feeding into low investment. So what I'm going to try and understand is, why is it that in spite of banks having been transferred windfall gains in terms of treasury prices going up through this whatever it takes announcement, you didn't actually see the kind of improvements in real economic activity that happened. And the main story is going to be as follows, which is that the OMT announcement did benefit banks significantly, as I said, because these banks were holding large quantities of GIBS debt. And this kind of unconventional monetary policy where you're basically saying, listen, I stand ready to do open market operations, you improve the prices of government bonds. I think these are now being seen as ways of indirectly recapitalizing your banks. So whichever assets are sick, you try to improve the value of these assets. And the hope is that without actually requiring a fiscal injection, you are indirectly recapitalizing banks when you do this. Now, the problem is that I will show that while the gains to equity were substantial, the equity in the balance sheet was so tiny to start with that even if you doubled it, actually the leverage of these banks was still actually pretty high. Okay, which is that the indirect form of recapitalization that was attempted didn't actually fundamentally recapitalize the balance sheet in a very substantial way. Even though if you narrowly looked at what are the gains to equity, you are improving things a lot. So let me just clarify this because this is an important point, which is that suppose you have a balance sheet of 100 euros and 1 euro out of that is equity. So it has a leverage of 100:1 basically on a very small unit of equity, you have levered 99 units of leverage, and then you have extremely high leverage. It'll only take 1% shock to wipe out the equity. Now, suppose you improve the value of assets from 100 to 100.1. Okay, or 100.2, whatever you want to take. That will improve the value of equity from 1 to 1.1 or 1.2. Being residual claimants, they will be the primary beneficiary of these gains. Now, on an equity sense, you've improved the value of equity by 10% or 20%. Okay, but if you think about the leverage of the balance sheet, it really hasn't changed that much. It has gone from 100.1, 100.2, to a base of 1.1, 1.2, which is basically still a leverage of very close to 100. Okay, so the question is, when you do something like this, what is the impact on the incentives of the banks and so on? So we find that these capital gains did, and simultaneously ECB had actually done a huge lender of last resort, as I was mentioning earlier. So what was the impact of this? We find that it did lead to an increase in loan supply. But interestingly, because the banks were so undercapitalized to start with, the increase in loans that happened didn't actually happen to the right kind of borrowers. So what we find is that it happens mostly to below median quality borrowers. It's not fresh lending. It's primarily from banks who had been lending to this below median quality borrowers in any ways. And I'll show that, and maybe in interest of time, I'll focus on this one main result, that most of the lending that happens is of zombie lending type, which is that you have a financially distressed borrower and you give them an extremely low interest loan, which looks primarily as though you are trying to avoid recognizing a bad loan. So whatever additional liquidity you are able to get from ECB or from the market, you end up providing this liquidity to your worst borrowers in the hope that if you can change the maturity of this loan effectively by 3 or 5 year period, you are postponing the problem by that time. Maybe things will turn around and that's good. Now, all of this would be fine if these firms actually improve their real economic outcomes as a result of these extra lending. Now, two things happen. One, whenever you are doing zombie lending, you want to not recognize bad loans, so you are giving credit to bad loans, and you don't find it as attractive to make loans to healthy corporations, because if you make loans to healthy corporations, you have to cut credit somewhere else, which means you might have to cut credit to a zombie firm, but then you have to recognize the zombie firm as a non-performing asset, because without the rollover, they will not be able to actually repay the loan to you. So on the one hand, you are increasing the cost of credit to healthy firms because you actually prefer lending to a worse firm. And second, you are also preventing the exit of the unhealthy firm from the sector. So that's going to mean continuing price pressure, wage pressure, etc., for the healthy firms in the sector, as a result of which they might not find investments in the sector as attractive. Simply put, there's excess capacity in the sector that needs to get cleaned up. Otherwise, these firms wouldn't have gone in distress in the first place. But because they are not leaving the sector, no further investment in the sector looks attractive because there's excess capacity relative to utilization. And so I'll try and document some of these things. Now, the important identification to show that it's really the capital of the balance sheet of the bank, which is the driving factor here, I'll show that this is not a property of healthy banks. So healthy banks and undercapitalized banks, at the same time, I'll show that the healthy banks are actually leaving the loans that have been made to the zombie firms. They are actually leaving the syndicates, and healthy balance sheets do continue lending to healthy firms. It's primarily the undercapitalized banks that are allocating their liquidity or credit in a bad way. So what were the financial and real effects? The non-zombie firms, I think I already mentioned that, which is, let's go to the last part, which is that in the long run, the presence of zombie firms depresses the employment and the investments in the sectors where a lot of this form of zombie lending takes place. And there are some numbers there, but to just put it in years terms, what I'll show you is that it leads to between 2 to 3 years of loss of investment by the healthy firms. So if you think about what is the impact of undercapitalized banks lending poorly, if you try to translate that into an economic magnitude using some sorts of counterfactual estimations, we show that it meant that the healthy firms in this sector lost between 2 to 3 years of the normal time investment that they would have made for two reasons. One, because their cost of credit went up, and two, because the capacity utilization in the sector is not coming down. And second, it's not just bad for real economic activity, it's actually bad for the banking sector itself. Because we find that banks, which around the time of the OMT engage in a high fraction of zombie lending, in 3 to 5 years' time, by the time these zombie loans are going to come to roost, over that period, we find that their non-performing loans to gross ratios, it rose to 16%, whereas it was 7.5% by the end of 2015 or 16 in our sample for banks which were well capitalized and didn't do too much zombie lending. So in some sense, it really looks like you kicked the can down the road because you didn't fundamentally recapitalize the balance sheet. You tried to do a little bit of surgical, you should have done a surgical repair of these balance sheets, but you just tried to do a little bit of unconventional monetary policy saying, let me improve the prices of the bonds that they are holding and hope everything will be fine at that point. So in any case, that's the broad paper. So in some ways, I think the message is that if you want to use unconventional monetary policies like giving guarantees that I will purchase or doing actual quantitative easing itself, our view is that it works better if you do it the way the United States did it, which is you first recapitalize your banking sector and then you give whatever extra stimulus you want, because then they have the right incentives to lend. They might not lend right away because maybe the demand hasn't picked up, but at least a well-capitalized bank won't have the incentives to make bad loans and become riskier further down the road. So that's sort of maybe the most useful policy conclusion. Okay, so the data we use is kind of a slightly complicated intersection of corporate finance database, which is the MADS of Bureau van Dijk in Europe, and then the Thomson Reuters deal scan database, which gives you bank to firm matched syndicated loans data. So even though we are looking for effects of poor transmission or banks being important, we are actually focused still on relatively large firms which are borrowing in the syndicated loan market. We think that if we had data on smaller bank-dependent firms, many of the effects we document might be even stronger, because the firms we are going to look at might potentially have access to other forms of finance. All in all, our data consists of 980 private borrowers which are going to borrow from 49 lead banks from various European countries. Okay, so let me first just document the effect on bank health and then move to bank lending. I think I'll be happy if I can show you that primarily, and then if there is time, I'll probably make in real effects, maybe show you a couple of graphs, and then maybe I'll try and show you at least the zombie distortions that arise. Okay, so the kind of treasury gains I'm talking about are very common. In fact, if you look at in India, for example, over the part of the cycle where interest rates were in an accommodative stance, you will see actually that one way the banks continued to meet the capital requirements was because whatever portfolios they were holding of treasuries, they appreciated in value during the accommodative cycle, and those treasury gains keep recapitalizing the banks a little bit every time the interest rates are cut. So the same way in Europe, what happened when the bond prices improved, you can see here a quote from one of the bank's annual report, UBI Banca, that's an Italian bank. So they say that the effects of the narrowing of the BTP, which is the Italian bond, to Bund, which is the German bond spread, entailed an improvement in the market value of our debt instruments with a relative positive net impact on the fair value reserve, which gets added to the capital base of the bank, of euro 855 million. In December 2011, the total equity was about 10,000 million, and so this amounts to a gain of 8.6% of total equity. Okay. And you can see this, one way to estimate these gains is to take the sovereign bond holdings of each bank in each country, see around the OMT announcement, say over the next 2 days or 3 days, what is the change in the prices of the bonds, and estimate what is the windfall gain that got conferred to the bank because of the whatever it takes announcement speech. Okay, so I'm going to measure this OMT windfall gain for a bank B in country J as change in the value of the Eurozone sovereign debt that this bank was holding divided by its total equity prior to the OMT announcement. And what you see is that for GIPS banks, which is the banks from the troubled periphery countries, these gains are massive. They are 8%, whereas for the non-GIPS banks, they are small, on the order of 1%. And that's not surprising because the GIPS banks are owning on average about 12% of their balance sheet in the form of their domestic sovereign bonds, whereas the non-GIPS banks only have about 1% of sovereign bond holdings. In fact, in some other research, I've documented that this kind of portfolio itself becomes a banking strategy, which is that banks want to bet on the central bank going into an accommodative cycle. And instead of using their deposits to lend, they basically just start buying government bonds because it becomes a cheap way of betting on an accommodation by the central bank. And then you keep adding every quarter the gains that you are making on your bonds. You don't have to actually do credit origination. But it's a bet, and I think it by and large traps the monetary policy, which is now if you have to raise interest rates, this capital is going to get wiped out and you're going to have now start having a larger and larger collateral damage on the balance sheet. So the important point is that despite the significant equity gains, many banks in the periphery actually remained very highly leveraged. Okay, so if you took their balance sheet equity and compared it to the leverage they had, you get a whole range from anything from 20 to 60 to 70. But on average, the leverage of the banking sector as a whole was 21. And so there are many banks that are levered in our sample to 30:1. 30:1 would mean that for every 100 euros, you have only 3 units of equity. So it'll take a 3% shock in your assets to wipe out your equity. And in fact, we have banks that have leverage of 50:1. So it will only take 2% collapse in your asset values to actually wipe out the equity of these banks. And so we are going to exploit this cross-sectional variation, which is that even after having transferred these gains and having injected close to €1 trillion of liquidity 6 months prior to this, there are many banks that are still fairly undercapitalized in the European banking system, especially in the GIPS countries. I think I'll skip that. Okay, so I'll try and convey what I have to say in pictures in interest of time, but we have careful econometrics to tease out many of these effects. Okay, so the first thing I want to show you is that if you just focus on quantity of new loans or credit growth, then you can come up with fairly wrong macro conclusions. Okay, so what I'm showing you here is the credit growth on a quarter-to-quarter basis. On the vertical line is the OMT announcement. The red line are banks which are better capitalized. They don't have a lot of exposure to the risky European countries, and therefore they don't actually have any windfall gains. In fact, they don't have any funding problems either. They are able to access wholesale finance and so on. So that's the red line. You can see that the credit growth there is basically essentially flat over this period. Then you see the high gain banks. You can see that these high gain banks are showing a huge increase in credit growth post the OMT announcement. Okay, and so on a first pass, you would conclude that, okay, this intervention has worked. Okay, I've been able to get my undercapitalized banks to actually start lending, and the loan volumes are increasing in the economy in a very substantial way. Okay, but then when you look a little bit deeper, and I'm going to now start showing you these partitions, what you find is that, so there are two things that we found that made us suspect what is going on, which is that we found that the increase in lending was all at the intensive margin. Okay, so it was not the case that the there were new borrowers who were getting credit, or that banks were lending to existing borrowers but with whom they didn't have relationships before. So the banks might have been, the borrowers might have been connected to other banks, but now they were getting credit from elsewhere. And if you looked at within that blue line, who are the borrowers that are getting the loans, it was actually the lowest quality borrowers who were actually getting the loans. So then we actually started, we thought this was interesting, and we said, let's look around if people have been talking about this credit composition, so to speak. And then we started finding these articles in FT and some other local newspapers, which were actually recognizing that there was this credit composition problem. And in fact, this very nice article in Financial Times, companies, the rise of the zombie, they were saying that the zombie problem, in which it's the wrong kind of firms which are very distressed, are the ones who are hogging all the credit, the new credit that's getting created. They said that it's focused in the periphery of Europe, and because banks are reluctant to pull the plug on companies, as it would force them to crystallize heavy losses. That would lead to wiping out of the tiny slivers of capital that you have, force regulatory actions, get you to issue new capital, which shareholders never want to do, because that primarily goes into stabilizing the bank rather than increasing the value of equity. So what we do is we are going to try and now get at how do we identify that this credit allocation is bad. Okay, we have to do a few things to get at this. So the first thing we are going to try and see is, you know, just because a loan gets made to a firm that looks risky, one should not necessarily conclude that it's because of perverse incentives. Because, you know, maybe you could price the credit. So, you know, you could actually make the loan at a high enough interest rate that even though you are taking the risk, it's actually compensating you for the balance sheet risk that you are taking on at the same time. But if your purpose in making the loan is not so much to recognize that you are taking risk and price it, but it's really to avoid risk in the first place, it would not make sense to make a high interest rate loan to a firm that is struggling to repay the loan in the first place. Because very next quarter is going to run into exactly the same problem. So you can charge a 15% interest rate, but how is this firm going to pay you the interest when it's actually struggling to repay the previous loan to you in the first place? So we are going to check if the credit looks super subsidized to these firms. So the way we are going to do it is, we are going to come up with what is the borrowing cost of the best rated firms in unaffected Eurozone countries. So we're going to look at AAA rated firms in Germany, France, and UK, and first use as a benchmark what are the borrowing costs for these firms when they borrow from banks. And we are going to be super conservative. We are going to identify loans as being super subsidized if the borrowing cost of a distressed firm is lower than this benchmark rate that I have constructed. Okay, and I'm going to say now this starts looking suspicious, okay, which is that banks are extending credit to the weakest firms at a cost of borrowing that is lower than the safest firms that are around in the Eurozone. Not the safest firms just in Italy. I'm actually taking safest firms in a country where there is no macroeconomic problem like Germany, France, or UK. Now, so I have to do a little bit more to then show you that this in fact looks like zombie credit, but I'm going to first go down this path. By the way, this method was used for the Japanese crisis by Kebeiro, Hoshi Kashyap, and Gianetti and Simonov, saying that we can't just use the fact that you've made a loan and say this is a zombie loan. I have to actually check that you have great interest in avoiding a default on this loan. Okay, so first I'm just going to show you, if I call these loans as zombie loans or super subsidized credit, what happened to the patterns of this credit. Okay, so the first thing is that leading up to the OMT announcement, what's plotted on the y-axis here is the asset weighted zombie fraction, okay, which is what fraction of the loans that are being made to firms by the European banks have this property. Okay. What you find is that leading up to the OMT announcement, the zombie lending was actually coming down. Okay, so to just explain to you what was happening in that period, this is a period when actually banks are getting hit on their balance sheet by the widening of the Italian and Spanish bond spreads. They are losing their access to wholesale financing, and so they are actually cutting back on bank lending. My interpretation is that this was market discipline. They were not getting funding in the market, they were losing capital, and so to restore confidence in the funding markets, they are actually now gradually cutting back on rolling over loans to these firms. But once the OMT was announced, you see that from below 4% or around 5%, depending on, we have two different measures depending on how you, from which data set you get the interest cost. So you can either get it from the new loans, or you can measure the interest cost of the firm from the balance sheet of the firm. Now, one gives you an average cost of borrowing, the other gives you the marginal cost of borrowing, but we see the marginal cost only on the loans rather than the entire liabilities of the firm. And therefore, we just use both measures to check that our conclusions are robust. So what you see is that you get a significant jump in the super subsidization of credit. Close to 12% of the bank loans on average weighted by the assets of the firm now start looking like, okay, this is super subsidized credit that is being made out there. The highest fractions, unsurprisingly, are in Italy and Spain because their banks are the most undercapitalized. So that's about 16% to 19% of loans. And the lowest fraction is in Germany, which is just at the average sample pre-OMT. Okay, now what we do then is we use an interest coverage ratio for these firms. So we look at what is the EBITDA or the cash flow that you are generating in a quarter relative to your short-term interest payments which are coming due. Okay, so it's a very common credit risk ratio that's used, for example, by rating agencies, by credit analysts, etc. We are going to call a firm as a high-quality firm if its interest coverage ratio is above the median in the sample. And all firms which are below, we are going to call them as low-quality firms. Okay. Now, not every low-quality firm is receiving super-subsidized credit in the sample. So that sample I'm going to call as low-quality non-zombie sample. And then the low-quality firms that are getting this super-subsidized credit, I'm going to call that as the zombie firms. Okay. And then what I'm going to show you next is that the firms that are getting super-subsidized credit are the ones that actually look worst even within the sample of the low quality firms. Okay, so one argument could be that the low quality firms that I'm lending to, they really just have a liquidity problem, but actually fundamentally their balance sheets are sound. So the interest coverage has gone down because there's a temporary shock to profitability, but on all other fronts, these balance sheets are actually the better balance sheets out there. But what I want to show you is that exactly the reverse is true here. Okay. So I'll focus on the following ratios. So you can see the interest coverage first of all. So these zombie firms are indeed the firms that have very low interest coverage. Then you can look at the net worth of the balance sheet of the borrower, which is how much net worth they have relative to their liabilities. You can see that that's lower by 3 percentage points as well, and that's statistically significant. You can look at the profitability of the firm, EBITDA to assets, that's lower by 1.4 percentage points. These firms are 4 percentage points more levered, so instead of 65.4%, the leverage is 70%. And you can see that in contrast, there is no difference in the characteristics of these loans otherwise. So what I'm documenting here is that the firms that you think should be getting the support would be the ones where the balance sheet looks fine, but actually the lower interest cost is actually for those firms where the balance sheets are actually looking worse. Okay. So that's one result, and that's sort of some prima facie evidence that this might be zombie lending. Now, second, the channel for zombie lending, the incentive is that I shouldn't be forced to recognize this loan as being a problem. Because once I do that, that's going to result in a wiping out of my capital. So which bank would actually have stronger incentives to do this zombie lending? It's going to be the weak banks. So now I'm going to show you that what gives us further confidence that this lending is happening to avoid losses is that I'm going to show you for the same syndicates what happens to undercapitalized banks' lending behavior versus better capitalized firms' behavior. So the ideal experiment would be the following. Okay, so there's a loan syndicate to the same borrower. There are some banks in this syndicate which are very undercapitalized, and there are some banks in the syndicate which are better capitalized. Now, what should happen under the zombie lending story is that the undercapitalized banks would not want to recognize the loss. How do you not recognize the loss? You have to extend further credit to this firm to extend the maturity of this loan. Now, for a well-capitalized firm, this is not an important consideration. They would rather take the loss and use their liquidity to actually lend to a better firm, because that's going to generate a higher profit on average. They would say, why should I give a super subsidized credit where I'm not going to earn anything when I actually have surplus capital in my balance sheet to make healthy loans? Okay. Now, of course, if the well-capitalized firm, a bank, leaves the syndicate, then the undercapitalized banks have to lend even more to roll over. Okay, so what's happening is actually even more perverse than I have pictured so far, which is that the weakest banks are going to pay off the strongest banks on the weakest borrowers. And now they're going to even increase their exposure to these weakest borrowers, because now you have to pay off the stronger banks in order to keep this firm from being classified as a non-performing asset. And that's exactly what happens in the raw data. I'm going to show you the aggregates over here. So we divide our banks into this high windfall banks and low windfall banks, which is the same as undercapitalized and better capitalized banks. And you can see that leading up to the OMT, the proportion of firms that are receiving zombie loans has essentially parallel trends. Okay, which is that it is the case that the well-capitalized banks are doing less lending that looks like zombie lending. But you can see that the trends are actually very parallel between these two categories. But post-OMT, when you get access to liquidity and you get slight benefit in your capital, so you want to start lending again, you can see that the patterns now completely diverge. The healthy banks are leaving the syndicates, so they actually cut back on zombie lending. And the undercapitalized banks are actually increasing their zombie lending by a very significant amount. So this is shown for Italy and then Spain and Portugal on the right hand side. And we actually went and dug up these firms, and then we went to see in newspapers, was there any coverage about what's actually happening to this firm. So here's one example, which is Feltrinelli. It's a private Italian publishing company, so it is dependent on bank credit. It came under severe stress during the sovereign crisis from 11 to 13. So in the Italian newspaper, which is La Repubblica, there's a lot of account of these firms having to deal with difficult labor problems, its sales having contracted by 11% during the sovereign crisis, and so on. And we find that right after OMT, it receives a new loan from UniCredit and Intesa San Paolo. The interest coverage of the firm is negative because the firm is making losses, so it doesn't have any cash flows to repay these loans. The interest rate on the debt, which is going to be now maturing in 2015 after extension, is 1.3%. And the corresponding AAA rated firm's borrowing interest rate for borrowing is 1.4%. Okay, so a loss-making firm that's been suffering sales contraction, etc., for 2 years is getting a 10 basis point subsidy. Now, what's interesting is that the loans that were made prior to OMT did not have this interest subsidization property. The pre-OMT loan had 4.7% as the interest cost when the benchmark rate was 2%. So the spread of 270 basis points that these firms were paying has now switched to a negative 10 basis point spread. So we can do all of this through regressions, and essentially what we find is that if you are one standard deviation more undercapitalized, then your loan volume is to non-zombies is going to increase by 2.5%. That's sort of the main result we have. Okay, so what is the impact of all this on the firms? I won't go through the regressions, but let me just tell you what we find. What we find is that these zombie firms, they take their cash and they use it primarily to repay their debts. So they don't actually engage in any investment, sales growth, or employment growth, because the new loans that they are getting, they are using it to repay some of the other debts that they have. So think about what I just said. You're getting a loan from an undercapitalized bank. What is it getting used for? It's getting used for to pay off the better capitalized bank that you have out there, because you don't want to be recognized as an NPA by any bank in the system, because once you do that, everyone has to recognize you as an NPA in the system. And the non-zombie low-quality firms, they use the new loans to build up their cash reserves. So we find that it's not the case that other firms that are getting these loans are actually making any investments either. If other firms get new loans, they are simply acting in a precautionary mode. They are just saving cash. They are not making any investments either. And next, I want to try and explain why is that the case, which is why is it that even if loans get made to the better firms in these sectors, they are also actually not making any investments. Okay. So what we do is the following. We do sectoral regressions for each country to relate. So we first construct a measure of what proportion of firms in a sector can be classified as zombie firms using that receiving super subsidized credit when you are actually below interest coverage firm in the sector. And then we run simple regressions in normal times of if this is the proportion of zombie firms in a sector, what are the outcomes of investment, employment, sales growth, etc. for healthy firms in the sector. Now, of course, we can run this for zombie firms as well. Why are we running these regressions? Because post-OMT, we get a shock to the proportion of zombies. Okay, so what I'm going to do is almost use this outcome as a shock to do my counterfactual exercise. So you can see that the OMT creates this shock in the proportion of zombie firms in the economy. This is actually going to vary sector by sector, of course. So if I have pre-crisis estimates of relating the proportion of zombies to the investment, sales growth, and employment outcomes for healthy firms in the sector, then I can use this change in the zombie fraction as a shock to estimate what would have happened to these firms had the zombie fraction not actually increased. Okay, so as you can imagine from the narrative I've already given, that the proportion, that the signs are going to be negative, which is that the higher the zombie fraction of firms in the sector, the lower is the investment, sales, and employment for the healthy firms in the sector. But now, because you get a big shock, of course, your investment, etc., would collapse even further. And that gap I can call as the impact of actually doing the zombie lending in the sector. So let me then just come to the final results. So what happens to the sectors? So now I'm again, just to show you this graphically rather than through regressions, I'm going to look at sectors where post-OMT there is a very big increase in the fraction of zombie firms versus where there is a low increase in the fraction of zombie firms. And you can see that this is a measure of productivity, that the productivity outcomes are similar leading up to the OMT. But post-OMT, because this sector experiences a big increase in zombie firms, the productivity for the other healthy firms in this sector collapses, and in the other sectors, it picks up. Okay, so when you don't give subsidized credit to distressed borrowers in a sector, the non-distressed borrowers in the sector become more productive.
And by productivity, this is investment, sales, and employment?
No, by productivity, we have a different measure out there. I'm forgetting exactly how we measure that. But we find that essentially as the fraction of zombie firms increases, the employment growth collapses, the capex collapses, and the productivity goes up. I have to see the exact definition. It's probably some measure of profits you are generating on the capital you deploy. So I think it would be like a return on investment sort of measure. So here's the broad counterfactual summary of the results. So we go sector by sector. So just focus on construction because that's one of the big sectors that gets affected. the top panel is for investment and the bottom panel is for employment. So the average investment is of the following type, that in construction sector, in the GIPS countries, you are investing 10% of your capital as new investment. Okay, that's the average capex rate that you have in normal times. Post-OMT, the zombie fraction increases 17 percentage points. Okay, so that's much more than the average 10 or 12% because this is one of the worst sectors worst performing sectors in the periphery countries. Now, using the estimates that we get here, which is how are the non-zombie firms getting affected as a fraction of the zombies in the sector, and then I know what is the change in the fraction of zombie firms in this sector, we estimate that the investment loss that you made would be 23.8% of capital. Okay, now because on average you were investing 10% of your capital, then our estimate is that this amounts to about 2.5 years loss of investments for the economy. Okay, which is that the subsidized credit created investment loss of 2.5 years for the healthy firms in the sectors to which you extended credit. And recall that I already showed that the zombie firms did not actually increase any investments. They are just repaying their debts down with the loans that they got. If you look at employment, then you get that the construction sector was losing 2.26% on average of employment. Because the fraction of zombie firms increases by 17%, then our estimate is that they actually lost 8.5 percentage points of employment on top of this 2.5%. Okay. So these losses are very large. The reason why we added this final section to the paper is that the usual argument given is that, oh, if you cause these firms to wind down, that if they get recognized as NPA, they would have to wind down because no one will extend credit to them, and that would result in job losses, that would result in loss of investment, etc. So one, we are showing that it's not the case that they restore their investments or job losses. Now you could say maybe the counterfactual would have been that they would have actually created job losses rather than at least keeping their employment where it is. But this misses the general equilibrium argument, which is that by keeping these firms alive, you are actually reducing the pricing power and investment prospects of healthy firms in that sector. And that is what we are documenting over here, which is that the standard argument given for forbearance on distressed firms, it's not quite complete because you also have to take into account the losses that you are making for healthy firms in these sectors. Okay, last point then. I know I'm running out of time a little bit. So the question then is, okay, even if you took the view that, okay, forbearance towards the firms was justified. Okay, so ignore the fact that you've actually destroyed the pricing power and capacity utilization, etc., in the zombie sectors. Then I want to make a limited point that even if you thought lending to these distressed borrowers was okay for whatever reasons you wanted to, the point I want to make is that this is not great for your banking sector, okay, which is that you've just kicked the can down the road and the non-performing loans are actually going to come to roost at some point down the road. Okay, so what I show here are these blue and red lines are the non-performing loans relative to the total loans. Okay, so what's the percentage of NPLs that you have? And of course, this is cumulative. So this is just the stock of NPLs that you have in each year. And you can see that the blue line, which is for undercapitalized banks that are doing a lot of zombie lending, is always slightly above the well-capitalized banks. But again, you can see that the trends were very parallel leading up to the central bank interventions. But once the intervention takes place and the zombie lending picks up, you can see that progressively each year, the undercapitalized banks are adding a far greater fraction of NPLs into their stock of loans. So the slippages are now picking up very, very significantly. And actually, by the end of 2016, the NPL fraction is about 15% for the worst banks. And this is the time when actually Italian banks started experiencing runs and finally they had to engage in a bailout and so on. So my sense is that all that the central bank did, perhaps, that they had to keep the Eurozone. So they succeeded in doing that. But there was a structural reform needed for the balance sheets of these banks at the same time, which was to fix their leverage or recapitalize them. But this didn't get done. And then you had even a bigger problem down the road over here. Okay, so I think I'll skip that. So let me just conclude. So we think that the unconventional monetary policy that the European Central Bank adopted, it did in the short run improve bank health because you conferred these treasury gains or bond government bond gains to the balance sheets. With the improved health, but not terribly improved health because you were still not that well capitalized, banks did increase their credit supply, but it was primarily to the low quality borrowers. And that this increase in credit was partly driven by zombie lending. No significant increase in employment and investment, but increasing fraction of zombie firms depressed investment and employment of better firms in the same industry. So in some sense, doing this trickle by trickle, small treasury gain sort of recapitalization didn't work very well because for a bank to lend well, it has to have substantially good capital buffers so that they just take losses on bad loans and start deploying their capital for generating better margin loans out there. So in some sense, my own priors are that if you have a banking sector balance sheet problem of the type Europe had, you can use monetary policy to stimulate the economy, but it will get transmitted in a proper way only through healthy banks. And so if you don't have healthy banks, then the transmission is going to go to the wrong firms, and then you have an even bigger banking problem down the road. So let me stop there. Thank you.